what Eugene Peterson does in John chapter 1, verse 14, in the Message translation. He says, and the Word became flesh and blood and moved in the neighborhood. The Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. I read something by Peter Lighthart that struck me, and I want to use that to lay a foundation for where I want to go. He said that to say that God is love is to say that God is himself the love by which he loves. Just as there was never a time when God was not father to his son, so there was never a time when God was not love. Love is not a disposition in God that comes to expression only in the creation and redemption of the world. Rather, God simply is and always has been the love by which he loves the world. I'm going to say that again. God simply is and always has been the love by which he loves the world. When we look at John's gospel is very fascinating to me, because just like when you're peeling an onion, there's so many layers upon layers. There's so many things that come to your mind and come to your heart as you begin to journey through the gospel of John. And unlike Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which give us the history of Christ, John spends a lot of time wrestling with the mystery of Christ. And when you really begin to understand John begins to describe himself as the one whom Jesus loved. And I have discovered that that is not just something that could be individualistic to him, but it speaks to all of us in this sanctuary, all of us around the world, that no matter where we are, no matter what's going on in our lives, no matter the things that are happening in front of us and around us, he loves us too. So he describes himself as the one whom Jesus loves. And so when we're reading John, we're really getting an understanding of love on fire. John's gospel begins to explain and unravel and unpack to us what love looks like when it is genuine, when it is pure. Some are going to be unwrapping presents or picking up things last minute scuffle today. And sometimes you just get a gift for the sake of being able to watch somebody unfold the gift. I didn't realize when I was younger, growing up, whenever it was time for Christmas, we made a deal with our parents, and they granted it after a certain number of years of pleading. And they let us open up one gift the night before Christmas. Just one gift. And one year, my mom let me pick out the gift myself. And I'm telling you, I thought heaven had came early, because I was just going crazy. And I'm pulling through the stuff, getting ready. And looking back, I realize now that the true joy wasn't in me being the recipient of the gift, but the true joy is the giver of the gift seeing me excited to receive it. Amen. And what I have discovered is that that is the same way God is with our lives. He is excited about the reality that what he did for us is greater than what we could ever do for ourselves. Amen. And so when we gather for the season of Advent, this time of Christmas, it is nothing but an understanding that we are the recipients of a gift that continues to give to us even when we have nothing to give to him. Amen. And John begins to remind us and understand this framework as he begins to say, in the beginning The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so he's beginning to wrestle with the understanding of that time period, because when we hear the word "word," we automatically think of words we speak. We think of words on a page. But when you begin to understand the Greek and the Roman mentality that was happening at that time, they had a different perspective on the concept of words. They understood it more as a blueprint. They understood it more as a blueprint. They understood it more as a message. And so they would look as this particular passage of scripture as to frame their minds and understanding that there was a message being released to them that they could not understand on their own. But it was God doing something they had never seen in a way that they least expect. When we look at the Christmas story today, we look at all of the pieces of commercialization. We look at Santa, and we look at Big Bellies, and we look at all the other pieces that we have commercialized. And even when we begin to look at the biblical story, there are a lot of things that we sometimes misinterpret nor misunderstand. Because the Christmas narrative, unfortunately, has become so simple in our eyes that we casually pass it by. But when you really begin to understand this moment in time, it is a moment of tension. And I don't know about you, but this has been a year of much tension in our nation.
Amen.
Every time you turn around, there's somebody arguing on CNN, somebody arguing on the news, and what's happening in the White House, and what's happening around the corner, and all the stuff that's been going on. It's a time of much tension. But during the season of Advent that we find in this particular time period, it was also a time of much tension.
Yes.
It was a time of fear, a time of trepidation in which people were trying to figure out what exactly was going to happen next. We live in that reality when we look at all the stuff that's going on right now in conflict concerning North Korea and conflict concerning other places and other people. But they were looking at it through a lens of not even knowing when they would finally be able to be set free. They had been under oppression and had been under attack for so long, it felt like God had forgotten them. When we look at time, we look at time through seconds. We look at time through minutes. We look at time through hours. But can you imagine if time continued to stop and a moment of silence that normally lasts 1 minute extended for 400 years? For 400 years, they had not heard a word from God. The heavens appeared to close on them. And so people were born and living and dying and moving as if everything was happening as normal. And they had gotten accustomed to not hearing from God. And what I love about God, church, is that when we hit a point in our lives on which we get too comfortable, God has a way of stirring our nests to get our attention. I'm talking to somebody this morning that you were literally in a moment in a season in your life in which everything was okay and everything was all right, and then all of a sudden one problem hit you this year. Who am I talking to? That you didn't anticipate, that you didn't expect, that one situation hit you this year, one crisis hit you this year, that you had no idea how you were going to get through. And we see the same tension in the biblical passage. They had been under attack for so long, their attack was normal. The Bible says the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So John begins to allow us to see and to understand that what God was in the midst of doing was something that was unthinkable and something that was disgusting in modern society of that time. because they had an understanding of the material world being bad. So anything done in the flesh, anything done in the body was automatically evil. So the thought process that God would stoop down so low and become a man was something that was beyond their own comprehension. But God did it so that he would be able to show us, I know what it's like to be you. I know what it's like to face what you've experienced, because I'm man enough to experience your pain, but I'm God enough to solve it. I'm man enough to see you in the midst of your ordeals, to see you with tears down your eyes, to see you in the midst of all kinds of stuff, but I'm God enough to send provision. And while they were in the midst of tragedy, while they were in the midst of turmoil, and they had no clear word from God, God decides to show up. And one thing I love about God is that when everything else has failed and when the people that made promises can't come through on those promises, he has a way of showing up. In the midst of my moment of pain, my moment of despair, he has a way of showing up when I'm unsure what's getting ready to happen next. And all of a sudden, the heavens begin to release to us something that we had been waiting on. Oh my God, some of us have been waiting on gifts and waiting on things for only a year. But can you imagine sitting by a Christmas tree and waiting for it your entire life, and your child grows up waiting for it and they never get it, your grandchildren grow up waiting for it and never get it? For over 400 years they were waiting for a gift that never came, but when the gift arrived they didn't even know it was there. And too many times we get so comfortable with where we are, we don't even see what's in front of us. Because the very answer to our problem is right in front of us. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The fuller understanding of that concept is not that the Word dwelt among us, but that the Word tabernacled among us. It was an allusion to the old covenant conversation, when in Moses' time they would come to the tabernacle, and when they came to the tabernacle in the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, the tabernacle had three particular spots. You had an outer court, you had an inner court, and you also had a holy of holies. Now I'm going to pause right there for a minute, because there's a principle tied to this. Too many times when we meet new people and new things, we let them in too quickly. Amen. The tabernacle is a pattern, not just in scripture and not just pointing to Christ, but is also a pattern for our lifestyle, that there ought to be layers to your heart. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Yes. There ought to be layers to your heart. Everybody should not have access to you the same way. So just as the tabernacle presents us a pattern of an outer court, an inner court, and a holy of holies, your life must also present the same pattern, that there's an outer court, people that you know, that you see, and then there's an inner court, people that are closer to you, and then there's the holy of holies. That should only be reserved for two or three people the most. The most dangerous thing that happens in communication is that we give too much too soon. The tabernacle is a picture to us, the sanctity of a sacred space. The Holy of Holies was only allowed to be entered by a priest. They had to come from a specific line. They had to be born into a specific family. But when Jesus arrived, he crashed the party, because he wasn't even born from the very people that they said you had to be born from. I thought about this, my brother, when I noticed and I received word, and we heard about the arrival of the new princess-to-be in England. She comes from a family that would technically not be considered royalty. And I thought that's a lot like Jesus, because in order for you to be a priest, you had to come from the tribe of Levi. But Jesus came from the tribe of Judah, and therefore if Jesus came from the tribe of Judah, he was not royal according to certain standards. Oh, every now and then God will crash the party, and he'll put people in places they don't deserve. He'll put people in things they don't deserve. He'll put people in times of trouble and times of turmoil. He'll position you strategically, not because of how good you are, but because of how great he is. And because he's great, he can do the impossible. The Bible says tabernacle had an outer court, an inner court, and a holy of holies. So when you look at this picture, it shows us in its description the cross. Take a step deeper. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Word became flesh and tabernacled among us. In the Old Covenant, the tabernacle was where we went. In Jesus, the tabernacle is who we are. So we are no longer going to a place. He put the place in you. So there's a tabernacle on the inside of you. What was the purpose of the tabernacle? It was to preserve and to protect the glory of God. So we don't have to just worry about the glory of God in a place, but there's glory on the inside of you. Which is why when you go through tests, when you go through trials, when you go through circumstances, all things are working together for you, because there's something on the inside of you that you haven't even tapped into yet. Look at somebody and tell them there's something on the inside of you. Got to be able to understand and how to recognize who you are, where you are, and what God is calling you to be. Moments where I need to be. The Word became flesh, tabernacled among us, full of grace and full of truth. I want to read this verse to you out of Psalm 85, and I'm going to give you three things, and then we're going to have church, and I'm going to head out the door. Let's look at this Psalm 85 and verse 10. Full of grace. Somebody say, full of grace.
Full of grace.
And truth.
And truth.
Notice now what happens. Notice now what happens. Psalm 85 says, mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. The psalmist is having a picture of what Jesus came to do. He's saying that when Jesus arrived in front of humanity, it was both mercy and truth coming together. And when mercy and truth come together, righteousness and peace have kissed each other. How is this tied? This is tied when we see his arrival. Bible says they brought forth her firstborn son. Everybody say firstborn son.
Firstborn.
Notice he is called the firstborn, not in terms of his physical genealogy, not in terms of his physical geography, but he is the firstborn of many brethren. He is the beginning of a new era. His arrival signifies everything has changed and things will no longer be the same. That's why you ought to get excited when Christmas time comes, when resurrection, when Easter comes, when Pentecost comes. We get too focused on the secular calendar instead of understanding the biblical Christian calendar, because these are set times of God's favor. So whenever we come into the period of Easter, whenever we come into the period of Christmas, we must understand that the heavens are open to release a special release on our lives because of what Jesus has accomplished through the cross. So notice what happens. She brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes. Jordan, I never fully understood how powerful this principle was, because I never fully understood how symbolic this moment was. They brought him forth. He was the first one to come. Notice they brought him forth. He was begotten, not made. So they brought him forth, and they brought forth her firstborn son. Son is capitalized because he's not just a regular son. He's not just a regular child. He's not a kid that you see on the corner around the street. He is the Son of God. Yes. And so when they brought him forth, they wrapped him in swaddling clothes. Swaddling was a ceremony that occurred in ancient Israel. But it was only reserved for priests and kings. So when they brought forth the child and they began to bring the child to them, the child now has to be dipped and bathed in salt water. Salt in that time period represented peace. So by them washing the baby in salt water, it meant that righteousness and peace are beginning to kiss each other. Because now they're washing the baby, cleansing him from any impurities, because his assignment is special. And then they wrapped him in swaddling clothes. Swaddling clothes is also symbolic of what happens when the Word becomes flesh and dwells among us. Because he has to dwell in the cloths for a certain period of time, in anticipation of his arrival as royalty. So the methodology that they used was symbolic, even though the people around them weren't able to see the picture. That's why you have to make sure in this season, hear me carefully, that you don't allow people to twist your perception. Because if you're not careful, they will twist what you see and you'll misinterpret what is being done right in front of you. Because there's something else that God has on his agenda. So when we look at this, we see three things. First of all, Christmas is, number one, a celebration. Christmas is a celebration. It was not celebratory at the moment. But they would celebrate once they realized who arrived. When Mary comes in, Mary has no idea the weight of what she's carrying. She did not even have the understanding to recognize the fullness of what it was until she had a visitation from God. Because of tradition of that time, whenever a woman bore a child and there was no marriage in it, she should have been stoned. So what she did almost guaranteed her death. I remember when I was in Israel in January of this year, and you literally can see there's a pretty good distance between Joseph's house and Mary's house, and the way the tunnels are set up, they have much space between where they were, but it was just about pretty close, wasn't too far from each other. And I began to understand and recognize how this could really be seen as something disgraceful. If Mary was alive today, she'd be on my wife's Instagram chats. People would be asking, did you hear about that young girl that they say is pregnant by a spirit? Pregnant by who? A spirit. Why in the world would a, how can a spirit, you know, they look at you, how many months are you? 9 months. Who's the father? A Holy Spirit. What is a Holy Spirit? They have never seen a Holy Spirit. It's a picture of what the Spirit is about to do. Is it possible that sometimes you go through things because you're carrying something we have never seen? And while she's carrying, in the midst of frustration, in the midst of shame, she receives a word that what she's carrying is the Son of God himself. And so they brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes. Christmas then is a celebration. But Christmas, hear me clearly, also secondly, is a proclamation. Christmas is a proclamation. It's a proclamation that the old is no more. and something new is on the horizon. Lean over to somebody and tell them the old is no more. The old is no more. Take me to church. The old is no more. The old is no more. I came to tell somebody this morning, this year's been crazy for you, but God said the old is no more. You're getting ready to step into something you've never seen before. I prophesy over this church right now, the old is no more. I don't care what it looked like at the beginning of the year. You're going to end this year different than the beginning of the year because the old is no more. Lean over somebody again and tell them the old is no more. Bible says she brought forth a firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in a manger because there was no room for him in the inn. So Christmas is a celebration. Christmas is a proclamation. But Christmas is also a demonstration. How is Christmas a demonstration? Notice they laid him in a manger. A manger is a food trough. A manger was a place that other animals would come and eat from. So a manger was a nasty, a dirty place. But he had to be put inside of a manger because the manger was also created from the remnants of wood. So by him being laid in the manger, it's a picture of him being eventually hung on a cross. Because the wood that was also in the manger is also symbolic of the wood that would be hung on the cross. And so it's a picture of what is to come. Look at somebody and tell you better read the signs in your life differently. You've been reading the signs as a curse. But that thing that you've been calling a curse is really a setup from God. The thing that looks crazy in your life is really a setup from God. And all you've got to do is not allow what people tell you, not allow what things happen in front of you, to recognize God is up to something in your life. I came to preach to somebody this morning who's had a hell of a year. Things happening everywhere you turn. Were the shepherds. I wrestled for a long time as to why the shepherds would be first, but then I understood that in Jewish history there were seven specific time periods, seven different individuals that were were not just shepherds, but were also shepherd kings. And the last time they had a shepherd king was David himself. But this arrival of this baby, this God in diapers, was not just a regular baby. It was the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. And the Bible says that when he arrives royally, laying inside of a manger. Nobody was coming to see him. Nobody was trying to take a picture. Nobody was trying to get a selfie, because they did not understand what had just happened. And God sent me to tell you, when you arrive, they don't always understand. But as long as you do what God called you to do, at the end, they'll know God sent you. At the end, they'll know God called you. At the end, they'll know you've been anointed. At the end, they'll know he's called. Because whom God calls, he equips. And who he equips, he calls. Touch somebody and tell them, I am anointed. The shepherds are first to hear him. And as the shepherds are first to hear him, I'm closing. They hear of his arrival. They had no other compass to know except the clues that were inside of the manger. They looked over and they received a word from an angel that he had come. But what we don't understand is that the shepherds were outside. Some scholars would argue that it had to be around the first of Nisan, which means they were outside during lamb season. I wish I could close this the way I want. They were outside during lamb season. So by them being outside during lamb season, they were already attuned to any arrival of lambs that were to come. Isaiah tells us that the lamb was slain from the foundations of the world. So the shepherds are the first ones to hear of Jesus' arrival, because they were already outside dealing with the lambs. They were doing what nobody else wanted to do, and they got access that nobody else had. God wants you to know in this season that the way to promotion is not by acting like everybody else, but it's going the extra mile. Because the shepherds were outside cleaning dirty sheep, they were able to be outside to get a visitation. It's not until you do what nobody else is doing that you can receive what nobody else has. That's why Jesus said, if you are faithful, you can then rule over many. I've got to be faithful with what I have to receive what he promised me. I've got to be faithful to what he gave me to receive my inheritance. If you believe it, jump on your feet and give God a praise. Look at somebody and tell them, here's the gift that keeps on giving. Whatever you need, whatever you believe in for, he is the gift that keeps on giving. Whether you have a tree, half a tree, no tree, whatever tree, doesn't make a difference. Christmas is not ascribed to trees. It's not ascribed to toys. It's not ascribed to any of that. Those are wonderful things. But it is a reminder of what Christ has done for us. It is a celebration. It is a proclamation. And it is a demonstration. And even now, let's extend your hands all over this house. No matter where you are, no matter what you got going on, he did it for you.
God bless you, my friend. I want to thank you so much for watching this video. I pray that a word was spoken that transforms and changes your life. Please stay connected with us, www.globalfirenow.com. I'd love to hear from you. Expect greatness.